Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Films from the Future, The Technology and Morality of Sci-Fi Movies, by Andrew Maynard, narrated by Matthew Waterson. Chapter 1. In the Beginning. I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that. Hal. Beginnings. I first saw Stanley Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey on a small black-and-white TV, tucked into a corner of my parents' living room. It was January 1st, 1982, and I was 16 years old. I wasn't a great moviegoer as a teenager. In fact, at that point, I could probably count the number of times I'd been to the cinema on one hand. But I was an avid science fiction reader, and having read Arthur C. Clarke's short story, The Sentinel, I was desperate to see the movie Kubrick and Clarke had crafted from it. So much so that every ounce of my teenage brattishness was on full display. My parents had friends around for dinner that evening, and, as usual, the drill was that I was either polite or invisible. But there was a problem. The only TV in the house was in the living room, which was precisely where, at 7:35 that evening, everyone else would be. I must have been especially awkward that day, because my parents agreed to let me put on my headphones and watch the TV while they entertained. And so, I snuggled into a corner of the sofa, pulled the black-and-white portable up, and became selfishly absorbed in Kubrick's world of the future. Goodness knows what our guests were thinking. 2001 A Space Odyssey is a movie that's rich with metaphors that explore our relationship with technology. So much so that, if I could reach back and talk to my 16-year-old self, I'd say, take note, this is important. I'd also add, don't be such a jerk, for good measure. However, despite being awed by the opening sequence, with its primitive apes and inscrutable black monolith, enthralled by the realistic space scenes, and shocked by the computer HAL's instinct for self-preservation, it would be another 30 years before I began to realize how powerful the medium of film is, especially when thinking about the future of science and technology in a complex human society. Back in 1982, I was entranced by 2001 A Space Odyssey because it exposed me to new ideas and new ways of imagining the future. Like many fans, I suspect, I ended up with quotes from the movie branded into my brain, like, "Open the pod bay doors, Hal," along with Hal's response, "I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that." Without my realizing it, Kubrick's movie made me think about a future where smart computers might decide that their self-preservation was more important than the humans who created them. Fast forward to the present, and, as we grapple with living in an increasingly complex world, I'm more convinced than ever that, for all their flaws, science fiction movies are a powerful way of exploring the technological futures we face and how to navigate them. Of course, it can be irritating when scriptwriters and directors play fast and loose with scientific and engineering reality for the sake of telling a good story. But getting too wrapped up in the minutiae of how accurate a science fiction movie is misses the point. These are stories about our relationship with the future, and, like all good storytelling, they sometimes play around with reality to reveal deeper truths. As it turns out, this creative freedom can be surprisingly powerful when it comes to thinking about the social benefits and consequences of new technologies, and how we can steer technology innovation toward more beneficial and equitable outcomes. It's this human dimension of science fiction movies that I'm particularly interested in. What these movies do rather well is provide us with a glimpse around the corner of our collective near future to help us see what might be coming down the pike and start thinking how we might respond to it. And they manage to do this because their scriptwriters and directors aren't encumbered by the need to stick to today's reality. Viewed in the right way, and with a good dose of critical thinking, science fiction movies can help us think about and prepare for the social consequences of technologies we don't yet have, but that are coming faster than we imagine. This is precisely what this book sets out to do. Using the 12 movies it's built around, the book provides glimpses into the technological capabilities we're building now, and how we might start to think about their beneficial and responsible development and use. Naturally, it only scratches the surface of the vast array of technologies that are beginning to emerge and the opportunities and challenges they present. But through the lens of these movies, the book sets out on a journey to explore what can go wrong with new technologies and how we can all help nudge them toward a future that looks better than the present we're currently in. And it continues that personal journey I started in 1982 with that first, barely conscious glimpse into how science fiction movies can reveal hidden connections between who we are, the society we live in, and the technologies we create. Welcome to the future. Google top science fiction movies, and you'll probably be overwhelmed by a deluge of top 100 lists, best ever compilations, and page upon page of the last word, supposedly, on must-watch movies. People are passionate about their science fiction movies, and they have strong opinions about what should be on everyone's watch list and what should not. Some of the movies in this book appear regularly on these lists: Jurassic Park, Chapter 2, and Minority Report, Chapter 4, for instance. Some are hidden gems that only the most dedicated fans cherish, including films like The Man in the White Suit, Chapter 10, and the anime movie Ghost in the Shell, Chapter 7. Others are likely to raise eyebrows, and I suspect there'll be a few movie buffs wondering why the collection includes films like Transcendence, Chapter 9, and Inferno, Chapter 11. This is a fair question. After all, why write a book about science fiction movies that aren't listed as being amongst the best there are? The answer is that this is not a book about great science fiction movies, but a book about how science fiction movies can inspire us to see the world around us and in front of us differently. Each of the movies here has been selected because it provides a jumping-off point for exploring new and intriguing technological capabilities and the challenges and opportunities these raise. Some of the resulting stories are life-affirming and heartwarming, while others are deeply disturbing. Individually, they provide fascinating accounts of the sometimes weird and complex landscape around emerging technologies. Together, though, they paint a much broader picture of how our technological world is changing and what this might mean to us and the generations that come after us. The movies themselves were selected after many hours of watching and soul-searching. There are some quite wonderful science fiction movies that didn't make the cut because they didn't fit the overarching narrative. Blade Runner and its sequel Blade Runner 2049, for instance, and the first of the Matrix trilogy. There are also movies that bombed with the critics but were included because they ably fill a gap in the bigger story around emerging and converging technologies. Ultimately, the movies that made the cut were chosen because, together, they create an overarching narrative around emerging trends in biotechnologies, cyber technologies, and materials-based technologies, and they illuminate a broader landscape around our evolving relationship with science and technology. And to be honest, they are all movies that I get a kick out of watching. In pulling these movies together and writing the book, I wanted to explore the often complex relationship we have with emerging technologies. But I also wanted to highlight some of the amazing advances we see beginning to emerge in science and technology. We truly do live in incredible times. Scientists are learning how to write and rewrite genetic code with increasing precision and efficiency. Nanotechnologists are designing and engineering materials that far exceed the properties of anything that occurs in nature. We are already creating artificial intelligence systems that can operate faster and smarter than any human. There are self-driving cars on our roads, with autonomous, people-carrying drones just around the corner. Researchers are working on brain-computer interfaces and mapping the human brain down to its individual neurons. And we may well see people walking on the surface of Mars within the next decade. Until recently, these and many more scientific and technological marvels were the stuff of science fiction. Yet the frenetic pace of innovation is rapidly catching up with some of our wildest imaginings. This is heady stuff to the physicist in me. At heart, I must confess, I'm still a technology geek. And yet this stupendous technological power comes with a growing obligation to learn how to handle it responsibly. Despite the speed with which we're hurtling toward our technological future, we are still grappling with how to do this in ways that don't end up causing more harm than good. This isn't because scientists and engineers don't care about who gets hurt. Most of them care deeply. But because we're charging headlong into a future that's so complex, it's becoming increasingly challenging to work out what could go wrong and how to avoid it. Navigating this future is going to require every ounce of insight we can squeeze out of our collective brains. And because the consequences of how we use new and emerging technologies will end up affecting us all, we all have a role to play here, including individuals who are all too easily overlooked by scientists and engineers. In fact, especially these individuals. Faced with this task, science fiction movies simultaneously remove barriers to people talking together about the future and reveal possibilities that might otherwise remain hidden. Every one of the movies here can be appreciated as much by someone who flunked high school as by a Nobel Prize winner. Because of this, they are tremendously powerful for getting people from very different backgrounds and perspectives thinking and talking together. But more than this, they have a way of slipping past our preconceived ideas of the world and revealing things to us that we could so easily miss. It's these unexpected insights that I've tried to draw out from each of the movies, building on my own work and experiences, as well as those of others. In doing so, I've been amazed at how powerful they are at revealing connections and ideas that aren't always obvious. I've been surprised and delighted at how these reflections have taken unexpected and serendipitous turns, opening up new ideas around how to approach beneficial and responsible technology innovation. But I've also been taken aback at times by the very real harm we could cause if we get things wrong. Not just to humanity as a whole, but to communities that all too easily slip between the cracks. And as I immersed myself in these movies, I've become more certain than ever that, fascinating as the minutiae of individual technologies can be, it's when they begin to converge that the really interesting stuff begins to happen. The power of convergence. In June 2007, the first generation of the Apple iPhone was released to the public. From the perspective of today's crowded smartphone marketplace, it's hard to realize how seismic an event this was at the time. Yet, looking back, it started a trend in how we use and interact with technology that continues to reverberate through society to this day. The iPhone stands as an iconic example of technological convergence. What happens when different strands of innovation intertwine together, a topic we'll come back to in Chapter 9, and the social and technological transformations that can occur as a result. These days, smartphones integrate hundreds of different technologies. Nanoscale featured processors and memory chips, advanced materials, cloud computing, image processing, video communication, natural language processing, rudimentary artificial intelligence, biometrics. They'll even allow you to make phone calls. They are a triumph of our ability to weave together separate technologies to make devices that are not only more than a sum of their parts, but are also transforming the ways we live our lives. But as the capabilities of smartphones and other personal electronics expand, there's a growing fear of serious unintended consequences. So much so that, in 2018, Jana Partners LLC and the California State Teachers Retirement System, two investors in Apple, requested the company actively address the potential impact of iPhone use on teenagers. Smartphones are a useful, but still rather crude, example of technological convergence. Expanding on this, we're now beginning to see convergence between biotechnologies, materials science, robotics, artificial intelligence, neurotechnologies, and other areas that are rapidly catching up with what used to be limited to deeply futuristic science fiction. This is seen across the movies in this book, from the use of genetic engineering in Jurassic Park, Chapter 2, to human augmentation in Ghost in the Shell, Chapter 7. The power of convergence between different technological trends particularly stands out in the movie Transcendence, Chapter 9. Here, the technology we see on the screen is firmly rooted in Hollywood fantasy. Despite this, the film captures the scale of technological leaps that become possible when technical know-how from one area is used to solve problems and accelerate progress in another. Transcendence is, at heart, a movie about transcending our biological and evolutionary heritage, inspired by the ideas of transhumanists like Ray Kurzweil. It imagines a future where convergence between biotechnology, neurotechnology, nanotechnology, and artificial intelligence leads to a profound shift in capabilities, albeit one with sobering consequences. There's a scene relatively early on in the movie where artificial intelligence, AI genius Will Caster, played by Johnny Depp, is dying, and his only hope is for his consciousness to be uploaded into a revolutionary new artificial intelligence-powered computer. But to achieve this, his colleagues need to use equally cutting-edge neuroscience and sensor technology to record and store every nuance of Caster's brain. In true movie fashion, they succeed just before he passes away, and Caster becomes a human-machine chimera who transcends his biological roots. The science and technology in Transcendence are fanciful, but as you peel away the Hollywood hyperbole, the movie hints at a coming level of technological convergence that could radically change the world we live in. This is rooted in our growing ability to blur the lines between physical technologies like materials, machines, and electronics, biological technologies like gene editing and biomanipulation, and cyber technologies like machine learning, natural language processing, and massive-scale data collection and manipulation. What unfolds in Transcendence is scientifically impossible, but what is not impossible, and what scientists and engineers are becoming increasingly adept at, is our growing ability to merge together and integrate seemingly different technologies to transform the world we live in. This is perhaps most apparent in emerging gene editing technologies, where scientists are developing the abilities to rewrite the DNA-based code that underpins every living organism, something that is only possible through converging technologies. But we're also seeing this convergence leading to massive advances in areas like designer materials, artificial intelligence, human-machine interfaces, and many others. For perhaps the first time, we are getting close to being able to far outstrip nature in how we design and engineer the world around us. This is where the true transformative power of convergence lies, and it's also where some of the greatest potential pitfalls are. Through converging technologies, we're developing capabilities that could radically improve lives by eradicating diseases, providing cheap and plentiful renewable energy, and ensuring everyone has access to nutritious food and clean water. At the same time, there are tremendous risks. We don't yet know how large-scale automation will affect jobs in the future, for instance, or how access to technologies may simply lead to the poor getting poorer and the rich richer. We have little idea how to wield increasingly powerful gene editing technologies responsibly, and we're not sure yet whether the rapid development of artificial intelligence is going to make the world a better place or lead to the end of humanity as we know it. The harsh reality is that, while convergence is massively accelerating our technological capabilities, we still have little, if any, idea what might go wrong, or what the unintended consequences could be. This is a theme that runs deeply through this book, and it's one that gets to the heart of the morality and the ethics of the science and the technologies we develop and use. If we're going to navigate the world of these converging technologies successfully, we're going to have to start thinking more creatively and innovatively about where we're going as a species, what could go wrong, and what we need to do to make things go right. Of course, movies are not the most reliable guide here, and I'd hate to give the impression that surviving and thriving in the 21st century is as easy as watching a few films. But they do provide a platform for exploring some of the more intriguing and important emerging and converging trends in technology innovation, and the tension between developing them responsibly and ensuring they reach their full potential. And here, they touch on another common theme that threads through the following chapters: the challenges and opportunities of socially responsible innovation. Socially responsible innovation. The movie The Man in the White Suit, Chapter 10, is perhaps one of the less well-known films in this book, but it is one that admirably highlights this tension between impactful and often well-intentioned innovation and unforeseen social consequences. In the movie, Sidney Stratton is a scientist with a vision, and that vision is to create the perfect fabric, one that's incredibly strong, doesn't wear out, and never needs washing. There's only one problem. He never bothered to ask anyone else what they thought of his invention. As a result, he finds himself attracting the ire of his co-workers, the textile industry, the local union, and even his landlady. Stratton made the classic mistake of thinking that, just because he could do something, others would love it. Even though the movie was made back in 1951, it eloquently captures the idea of socially responsible innovation. This is another theme that threads through this book, and it's one that is deeply intertwined with the opportunities and challenges presented by converging technologies. Responsible innovation, sometimes referred to as responsible research and innovation, is a hot topic these days. There's even an academic journal devoted to it. The thinking behind responsible innovation is that we don't always have a second or third chance to get things right when developing new technologies. And so it's better to think about the potential consequences as early as we can, and take action to avoid the bad ones as early in the development process as possible. There are plenty of formal definitions for responsible innovation, but many of these boil down to ensuring that anyone who is potentially impacted by technological innovation has a say in how it's developed and used, and taking steps to ensure innovation that leads to a better future for as many people as possible without causing undue harm. This is easy to say, of course, but fiendishly difficult to put into practice. This idea of social responsibility comes up time and time again in the movies here. In many cases, a film's dramatic tension draws directly on some person or organization not thinking about the consequences of what they are doing, or being too arrogant to see their blind spots. This is apparent straight out of the gate with Jurassic Park in Chapter 2. This makes for compelling narratives, but it also opens the way for surprisingly nuanced approaches to exploring what might go wrong with emerging technologies if we don't think of who they will impact and how we can steer them toward better outcomes. And it opens the door to delving into something that is near and dear to my heart, grappling with the risks of new and unusual technologies. Most of my professional life has been involved with risk in one way or another. Much of my early published scientific research was aimed at reducing the health risks from inhaling airborne particles. I've worked extensively on understanding and reducing the health and environmental risks of nanotechnology and other emerging technologies. I've taught risk assessment, I've written about risk, and I've run academic centers that are all about risk. And if there's one thing I've learned over the years, it's that I have less and less patience for how many people tend to think about risk. The problem is that, while established approaches to risk work reasonably well when it comes to protecting people and the environment from conventional technologies, they run out of steam rather fast when we're facing technologies that can achieve things we never imagined. To co-opt a biblical metaphor, we're in danger of desperately trying to squeeze the new wine of technological innovation into the old wineskins of conventional risk thinking. And at some point, something's going to give. If we're to develop new technologies in socially responsible ways, we need to realign how we think about risk with the capabilities of the innovations we're creating. This is the idea behind the concept of risk innovation, which is where much of my current work lies. Over the past couple of hundred years, pretty much since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, we've become quite adept at developing new ways of causing harm. And over time, we've become equally adept at developing ways of assessing and managing the risks associated with innovation, whether they arise from mining and manufacturing, exposure to new chemicals and materials, or pollution. But these approaches to risk belong to a different world than the one we're now creating. With emerging and converging technologies, it's becoming increasingly apparent that, in order to navigate a radically shifting risk landscape, we need equally radical innovation in how to think about and act on risk. Perhaps not surprisingly, risk is at the core of all the movies here. Each of these films has a risk-based narrative tension that keeps its audience hooked. Yet, it's not always apparent that it's risk that keeps you glued to the screen, or holding a breath, or even reaching for the tissues in places. Most of us are used to thinking about risk in terms of someone's life being put in danger, or perhaps the environment and ecosystems being threatened. And there's plenty of this in the book. But these movies also explore other, subtler risks, including threats to dignity, belonging, identity, belief, even what it means to be human. These are rather unconventional ways of thinking about risk, and they get at what is so important to us that our lives are diminished if it's denied us or taken from us. Because of this, they make considerable sense as we begin to think about how new technologies will potentially affect our lives and how to develop and use them responsibly. This is a way of thinking about risk that revolves around threats to what is important to us, whether it's something we have and can't face losing, or something we aspire to and cannot bear to lose sight of. This includes our health, our well-being, and the environment we live in. But it also extends to less tangible but equally important things that we deeply value. In each of the movies here, the characters we follow risk either losing something of great importance to them or being unable to gain something that they aspire to. In many of the movies, the types of risks these characters face aren't always immediately obvious, but they profoundly impact the consequences of the technologies being developed and used. And it's this insight that opens up interesting and new ways of thinking about the social consequences of technological innovation. And so we discover that, in Jurassic Park, Chapter 2, John Hammond's dream of creating the world's most amazing theme park is at risk. In the movie Never Let Me Go, Chapter 3, it's the threat to Tommy's hope for the future that brings us to tears. And in Ghost in the Shell, Chapter 7, it's Major Kusanagi's sense of who and what she is. There are also more conventional risks in each of these movies. Yet by revealing these less obvious risks, these movies reveal new and often powerful ways to think about developing new technologies without causing unnecessary and unexpected harm. In this way, the movies here provide what are often quite startling insights into the social challenges and opportunities surrounding emerging technologies. Watching them with an open mind and a critical eye can reveal subtle connections between irresponsible innovation and threats to what people value or aspire to, which in turn have profound implications for society more broadly. And this is where their creativity and imagination have the power to lift us out of the rut of conventional thinking and allow us to see opportunities and dangers that extend beyond the world of make-believe and into the technological future we are striving to create. In other words, I'm a sucker for using the imagination in science fiction movies to stimulate new ways of thinking about risk, and in turn, new ways of thinking about socially responsive and responsible innovation. But there's another aspect to these movies that also gets me excited, and that's their ability to break down the barriers between experts and non-experts, and open the door to everyone getting involved in talking about where technology innovation is taking us and what we want from it. A common point of focus. I was recently invited to a meeting convened by the World Economic Forum, where I was asked to moderate a discussion about how governments, businesses, and others can respond to the potential risks presented by new technologies. Much of our discussion was around regulations and policies and what governments and companies can do to nip problems in the bud without creating unnecessary roadblocks. But one question kept recurring. How can we ensure the safe and beneficial development of new technologies in a world that is so deeply and divisively divided along ideological lines? To my surprise, one of the participants suggested something that didn't involve politics, regulations, or more effective education: art. Naturally, we still need technical experts, laws, and policies if we're going to get new technologies right. But the question that was put forward was an intriguing complement to these. Can we use art, including all forms of creative expression, to pull people out of their entrenched ideas and get them thinking and talking about how they can work together to build the future they want? Obviously, we're never going to reach world peace and prosperity by insisting everyone contemplate Da Vinci's Mona Lisa or one of Damien Hirst's pickled cows. Yet art provides a common point of focus that allows people to express their ideas, thoughts, and opinions while being open to those of others. And it allows the possibility of being able to do this without slipping into ideological ruts. Art, in all its forms, is a medium that can mitigate our tendency to close down our imagination, together with our humility and empathy. And it's one that opens us up to seeing the world in new and interesting ways. In this context, science fiction movies are, without a doubt, a legitimate form of art, and one that has the power to bring people together in imagining how to collectively create a future that is good for society, rather than a dystopian mess, as long as that imagination is grounded in reality where it matters. This isn't to say that technical education and skills aren't important. They most certainly are. Developing technologies that work and are safe demands incredible technical skills, and it would be naive and irresponsible to discount this. No matter how inclusive we want to be, we can't expect a random person plucked from the street to have the skills necessary to genetically engineer organisms safely or to design aircraft that don't fall out of the sky. That would be crazy. But one thing we're all qualified to do is think about what the possible consequences of technology innovation might mean to us and the people we care for. And here, pretty much everyone has something to contribute to the socially responsible and responsive development of new technologies. This is something that I hope will become increasingly clear through the remainder of this book. But before we dive into the movies themselves, I do need to say something about spoilers. Spoiler alert. This is a book that contains spoilers. You have been warned. It's not a book to hear if you're one of those people who can't stand to know what happens before you watch a movie. But I can guarantee that if you listen to the book before seeing the movies, your experience will be all the richer for it. Even if you're familiar with the movies, you'll see them through new eyes after listening to the book. And if you decide not to watch the movies at all, that's okay as well. Certainly the movies are engaging and entertaining, but at the end of the day, it's the technologies that are the stars here. Each chapter starts with a brief overview of the movie it's built around. This is partly to orient you if you haven't seen the movie or you aren't particularly interested in watching it, although I'd hope that, after listening to the chapter, you head out to your preferred streaming service to get the full effect. But it's also to help set the scene for what's to come. If you know these movies well, you'll realize that the summaries are idiosyncratic, to say the least. They let you know what I think is interesting and relevant about each film, what grabs my attention when watching them, and what makes me think. But they don't give everything away. In fact, I'd hope that, watching any of the movies after listening to the book, you'd still be surprised and delighted by unexpected plot twists and turns. With that said, it's time to start the journey, starting with genetic engineering, resurrection biology, and the folly of entrepreneurial arrogance that is so adeptly captured by Steven Spielberg's original Jurassic Park. So buckle up, hang on, and enjoy the ride. Chapter 2. Jurassic Park, the rise of resurrection biology. God help us, we're in the hands of engineers. Dr. Ian Malcolm. When dinosaurs ruled the world. I was a newly minted PhD when I first saw Jurassic Park. It was June 1993, and my wife and I were beginning to enjoy our newfound freedom after years of too much study and too little money. I must confess that we weren't dinosaur geeks, but there was something about the hype surrounding the movie that hooked us. Plus, we fancied a night out. That summer, dinosaurs ruled the world. Wherever you looked, there were dinosaurs. Dinosaur books, dinosaur parks, dinosaurs on TV, dinosaur-obsessed kids. Jurassic Park seemingly tapped into a dinosaur-obsessed scene buried deep within the human psyche. This was helped along, of course, by the groundbreaking special effects the movie pioneered. Even now, there's a visceral realism to the blended physical models and computer-generated images that brings these near-mythical creatures to life in the movie. This is a large part of the appeal of Jurassic Park. There's something awe-inspiring, awe-full in the true sense of the word, about these terrible lizards that lived millions of years ago and that are utterly alien to today's world. This sense of awe runs deep through the movie. Listening to John Williams' triumphant theme music, it doesn't take much to realize that under the gloss of danger and horror, Jurassic Park is at heart a celebration of the might and majesty of the natural world. Jurassic Park is unabashedly a movie about dinosaurs, but it's also a movie about greed, ambition, genetic engineering, and human folly, all rich pickings for thinking about the future and what could possibly go wrong. Jurassic Park opens at a scientific dig in Montana, where paleontologists Alan Grant, played by Sam Neill, and Ellie Sattler, Laura Dern, are leading a team excavating dinosaur fossils. Just as the team discovers the fossilized skeleton of a velociraptor, a dinosaur that Grant is particularly enamored with, the dig is interrupted by the charming, mega-rich, and, as it turns out, rather manipulative John Hammond, Richard Attenborough. As well as being founder of the International Genetic Technologies Incorporated, InGen for short, Hammond has also been backstopping Grant and Sattler's digs. On arriving, he wastes no time offering them further funding in exchange for a quick weekend mini-break to his latest and greatest masterpiece, just off the coast of Costa Rica. We quickly learn that, beneath the charm, Hammond is fighting for the future of his company and his dream of building the ultimate tourist attraction. There's been an unfortunate incident between a worker and one of his park's exhibits, and his investors are getting cold feet. What he needs is a couple of respected scientists to give him their full and unqualified stamp of approval, which he's sure they will once they see the wonders of his Jurassic Park. Grant and Sattler agree to the jaunt, in part because their curiosity has been piqued. They join Hammond, along with self-styled chaotician Dr. Ian Malcolm, Jeff Goldblum, and lawyer Donald Gennaro, Martin Ferrero, on what turns out to be a rather gruesome rollercoaster ride of a weekend. From the get-go, we know that this is not going to end well. Malcolm, apart from having all the best lines in the movie, is rather enamored with his theories about chaos. These draw heavily on ideas that were gaining popularity in the 1980s, when Crichton was writing the novel the movie's based on. Malcolm's big idea, and the one he was riding the celebrity scientist fame train on, is that, in highly complex systems, things inevitably go wrong. And, just as predicted, Hammond's Jurassic Park undergoes a magnificently catastrophic failure. The secret behind Hammond's park is InGen's technology for resurrecting long-extinct dinosaurs. Using cutting-edge gene-editing techniques, his scientists are able to reconstruct dinosaurs from recovered dino DNA. His source for the dino DNA is the remnants of prehistoric blood that was sucked up by mosquitoes before they were caught in tree resin and preserved in the resulting amber as the resin was fossilized. And his grand plan is to turn the fictitious island of Isla Nublar into the world's first living dinosaur theme park. Unfortunately, there were a few holes in the genetic sequences that InGen was able to extract from the preserved blood, so Hammond's enterprising scientists filled them with bits and pieces of DNA from living species. They also engineered the dinosaurs to be all females to prevent them from breeding, and, just to be on the safe side, the de-extinct dinosaurs were designed to slip into a coma and die if they weren't fed a regular supply of the essential amino acid, lysine. The result is a bunch of enterprising scientists re-engineering nature to create the ultimate theme park and thinking they've put all the safeguards they need in place to prevent something bad happening. Yet, despite their best efforts, the dinosaurs start breeding and multiplying. A compromised security system and security specialist allows them to escape, and they start eating the guests. Even before the team of experts get to Jurassic Park, a disgruntled employee, Dennis Nedry, played by Wayne Knight, has planned to steal and sell a number of dinosaur embryos to a competitor. Nedry is the brains behind the park's software control systems and believes he's owed way more respect and money than he gets. At an opportune moment, he disrupts the park with what he intends to be a temporary glitch that will allow him to steal the embryos, get them off the island, and return to his station before anyone notices. Unfortunately, an incoming hurricane interferes with his plans, resulting in catastrophic failure of the park's security systems and a bunch of hungry dinosaurs roaming free. To make things worse, two of the guests are Hammond's young nephew and niece, who find their trip to the theme park transformed into a life-and-death race against a hungry Tyrannosaurus Rex and a pack of vengeful velociraptors. Fortunately, Sattler and Grant come into their own as paleontologists come action heroes. They help save a handful of remaining survivors, including Hammond, Malcolm, and his nephew and niece, but not before a number of less fortunate characters have given their lives in the name of science gone badly wrong. And as they leave the island, we are left in no doubt that nature, in all its majesty, has truly trounced the ambitions of Hammond and his team of genetic engineers. Jurassic Park is a wonderful Hollywood tale of derring do. In fact, it stands the test of time remarkably well as an adventure movie. It also touches on themes that are, if anything, more important today than they were back when it was made. In 1993, when Jurassic Park was released, the idea of bringing extinct species back from the dead was pure science fiction. Back then, advances in understanding DNA were fueling the fantasy that, one day, we might be able to recode genetic sequences to replicate species that are no longer around. But, by any stretch of the imagination, this was beyond the wildest dreams of scientists in the early 1990s. Yet, since the movie was made, there have been incredible strides in genetic engineering, so much so that scientists are now actively working on bringing back extinct species from the dead. The field even has its own name, de-extinction. More than the technology, though, Jurassic Park foreshadows the growing complexities of using powerful new technologies in an increasingly crowded and demanding world. In 1993, chaos theory was still an emerging field. Since then, it's evolved and expanded to include whole areas of study around complex systems, especially where mixing people and technology together leads to unpredictable results. What really stands out with Jurassic Park, over 25 years later, is how it reveals a very human side of science and technology. This comes out in questions around when we should tinker with technology and when we should leave well enough alone. But there is also a narrative here that appears time and time again with the movies in this book. And that is how we get our heads around the sometimes oversized roles mega entrepreneurs play in dictating how new tech is used and possibly abused. These are all issues that are just as relevant now as they were in 1993, and are front and center of ensuring that the technology-enabled future we're building is one where we want to live, and not one where we're constantly fighting for our lives. De-extinction. In a far corner of Siberia, two Russians, Sergei Zimov and his son Nikita, are attempting to recreate the Ice Age. More precisely, their vision is to reconstruct the landscape and ecosystem of northern Siberia in the Pleistocene, a period in Earth's history that stretches from around 2.5 million years ago to 11,000 years ago. This was a time when the environment was much colder than now, with huge glaciers and ice sheets flowing over much of the Earth's northern hemisphere. It was also a time when humans coexisted with animals that are long extinct, including saber-toothed cats, giant ground sloths, and woolly mammoths. The Zimov's ambitions are an extreme example of Pleistocene rewilding, a movement to reintroduce relatively recently extinct large animals, or their close modern-day equivalents, to regions where they were once common. In the case of the Zimov's, the father and son team believe that, by reconstructing the Pleistocene ecosystem in the Siberian steppes and elsewhere, they can slow down the impacts of climate change on these regions. These areas are dominated by permafrost, ground that never thaws through the year. Permafrost ecosystems have developed and survived over millennia, but a warming global climate, a theme we'll come back to in Chapter 12 and the movie The Day After Tomorrow, threatens to catastrophically disrupt them. And as this happens, the impacts on biodiversity could be devastating. But what gets climate scientists even more worried is potentially massive releases of trapped methane as the permafrost disappears. Methane is a powerful greenhouse gas, some 80 times more effective at exacerbating global warming than carbon dioxide, and large-scale releases from warming permafrost could trigger catastrophic changes in climate. As a result, finding ways to keep it in the ground is important. And here, the Zimovs came up with a rather unusual idea. Maintaining the stability of the environment by reintroducing long-extinct species that could help prevent its destruction, even in a warmer world. It's a wild idea, but one that has some merit. As a proof of concept, though, the Zimovs needed somewhere to start. And so they set out to create a park for de-extinct Siberian animals, Pleistocene Park. Pleistocene Park is by no stretch of the imagination a modern-day Jurassic Park. The dinosaurs in Hammond's Park date back to the Mesozoic period, from around 250 million years ago to 65 million years ago. By comparison, the Pleistocene is relatively modern history, ending a mere 11,500 years ago. And the vision behind Pleistocene Park is not thrills, spills, and profit, but the serious use of science and technology to stabilize an increasingly unstable environment. Yet there is one thread that ties them together, and that's using genetic engineering to reintroduce extinct species. In this case, the species in question is warm-blooded and furry, the woolly mammoth. The idea of de-extinction, or bringing back species from extinction, it's even called resurrection biology in some circles, has been around for a while. It's a controversial idea, and it raises a lot of tough ethical questions. But proponents of de-extinction argue that we're losing species and ecosystems at such a rate that we can't afford not to explore technological interventions to help stem the flow. Early approaches to bringing species back from the dead have involved selective breeding. The idea was simple. If you have modern ancestors of a recently extinct species, selectively breeding specimens that have a higher genetic similarity to their forebears can potentially help reconstruct their genome in living animals. This approach is being used in attempts to bring back the aurochs, an ancestor of modern cattle. But it's slow, and it depends on the fragmented genome of the extinct species still surviving in its modern-day equivalents. An alternative to selective breeding is cloning. This involves finding a viable cell or cell nucleus in an extinct but well-preserved animal and growing a new living clone from it. It's definitely a more appealing route for impatient resurrection biologists, but it does mean getting your hands on intact cells from long-dead animals and devising ways to resurrect these, which is no mean feat. Cloning has potential when it comes to recently extinct species whose cells have been well-preserved, for instance, where the whole animal has become frozen in ice, but it's still a slow and extremely limited option, which is where advances in genetic engineering come in. The technological premise of Jurassic Park is that scientists can reconstruct the genome of long-dead animals from preserved DNA fragments. It's a compelling idea if you think of DNA as a massively long and complex instruction set that tells a group of biological molecules how to build an animal. In principle, if we could reconstruct the genome of an extinct species, we would have the basic instruction set, the biological software, to reconstruct individual members of it. The bad news is that DNA reconstruction-based de-extinction is far more complex than this. First, you need intact fragments of DNA, which is not easy, as DNA degrades easily and is pretty much impossible to obtain, as far as we know, for dinosaurs. Then you need to be able to stitch all of your fragments together, which is akin to completing a billion-piece jigsaw puzzle without knowing what the final picture looks like. This is a Herculean task, although with breakthroughs in data manipulation and machine learning, scientists are getting better at it. But even when you have your reconstructed genome, you need the biological wetware, all the stuff that's needed to create, incubate, and nurture a new living thing, like eggs, nutrients, a safe space to grow and mature, and so on. Within all this complexity, it turns out that getting your DNA sequence right is just the beginning of translating that genetic code into a living, breathing entity. But in some cases, it might be possible. In 2013, Sergei Zimov was introduced to the geneticist George Church at a conference on de-extinction. Church is an accomplished scientist in the field of DNA analysis and reconstruction, and a thought leader in the field of synthetic biology, which we'll come back to in Chapter 9. It was a match made in resurrection biology heaven. Zimov wanted to populate his Pleistocene Park with mammoths, and Church thought he could see a way of achieving this. What resulted was an ambitious project to de-extinct the woolly mammoth. Church and others who are working on this have faced plenty of hurdles, but the technology has been advancing so fast that, as of 2017, scientists were predicting they would be able to reproduce the woolly mammoth within the next 2 years. One of those hurdles was the lack of solid DNA sequences to work from. Frustratingly, although there are many instances of well-preserved woolly mammoths, their DNA rarely survives being frozen for tens of thousands of years. To overcome this, Church and others have taken a different tack. Take a modern, living relative of the mammoth and engineer into it traits that would allow it to live on the Siberian tundra, just like its woolly ancestors. Church's team's starting point has been the Asian elephant. This is their source of base DNA for their woolly mammoth 2.0, their starting source code, if you like. So far, they've identified 50-plus gene sequences they think they can play with to give their modern-day woolly mammoth the traits it would need to thrive in Pleistocene Park, including a coat of hair, smaller ears, and a constitution adapted to cold. The next hurdle they face is how to translate the code embedded in their new woolly mammoth genome into a living, breathing animal. The most obvious route would be to impregnate a female Asian elephant with a fertilized egg containing the new code. But Asian elephants are endangered, and no one's likely to allow such cutting-edge experimentation on the precious few that are still around. So scientists are working on an artificial womb for their reinvented woolly mammoth. They're making progress with mice and hope to crack the motherless mammoth challenge relatively soon. It's perhaps a stretch to call this creative approach to recreating a species, or reanimation, as Church refers to it, de-extinction, as what is being formed is a new species. Just as the dinosaurs in Jurassic Park weren't quite the same as their ancestors, Church's woolly mammoths wouldn't be the same as their forebears. But they would be designed to function within a specific ecological niche, albeit one that's the result of human-influenced climate change. And this raises an interesting question around de-extinction. If the genetic tools we are now developing give us the ability to improve on nature, why recreate the past when we could reimagine the future? Why stick to the DNA code that led to animals being weeded out because they couldn't survive in a changing environment, when we could make them better, stronger, and more likely to survive and thrive in the modern world? This idea doesn't sit so well with some people, who argue that we should be dialing down human interference in the environment and turning the clock back on human destruction. And they have a point, especially when we consider the genetic diversity we are hemorrhaging away with the current rate of biodiversity loss. Yet we cannot ignore the possibilities that modern genetic engineering is opening up. These include the ability to rapidly and cheaply read genetic sequences and translate them to digital code, to virtually manipulate them and recode them, and then to download them back into the real world. These are heady capabilities, and for some there is an almost irresistible pull toward using them, so much so that some would argue that not to use them would be verging on the irresponsible. These tools take us far beyond de-extinction. The reimagining of species like the woolly mammoth is just the tip of the iceberg when it comes to genetic design and engineering. Why stop at recreating old species when you could redesign current ones? Why just redesign existing species when you could create brand new ones? And why stick to the genetic language of all earthbound living creatures when you could invent a new language, a new DNA? In fact, why not go all the way and create alien life here on Earth? These are all conversations that scientists are having now, spurred on by breakthroughs in DNA sequencing, analysis, and synthesis. Scientists are already developing artificial forms of DNA that contain more than the four DNA building blocks found in nature. And some are working on creating completely novel artificial cells that not only are constructed from off-the-shelf chemicals, but also have a genetic heritage that traces back to computer programs, not evolutionary life. In 2016, for instance, scientist and entrepreneur Craig Venter announced that his team had produced a completely artificial living cell. Venter's cell, tagged JCVI-SYN 3.0, is paving the way for designing and creating completely artificial life forms, and the work being done here by many different groups is signaling a possible transition from biological evolution to biology by design. One of the interesting twists to come out of this research is that scientists are developing the ability to watermark their creations by embedding genetic identity codes. As research here progresses, future generations may be able to pinpoint precisely who designed the plants and animals around them, and even parts of their own bodies, including when and where they were designed. This does, of course, raise some rather knotty ethical questions around ownership. If you one day have a JCVI-tagged dog, or a JCVI-watermarked replacement kidney, for instance, who owns them? This research is pushing us into ethical questions that we've never had to face before, but it's being justified by the tremendous benefits it could bring for current and future generations. These touch on everything from bio-based chemicals production to new medical treatments and ways to stay healthier longer, and even designer organs and body part replacements at some point. It's also being driven by our near insatiable curiosity and our drive to better understand the world we live in and gain mastery over it. And here, just like the scientists in Jurassic Park, we're deeply caught up in what we can do as we learn to code and recode life. But just because we can now resurrect and redesign species, should we? Could we? Should we? Perhaps one of the most famous lines from Jurassic Park, at least for people obsessed with the dark side of science, is when Ian Malcolm berates Hammond, saying, "Your scientists were so preoccupied with whether they could, they didn't stop to think if they should." Ethics and responsibility in science are complicated. I've met remarkably few scientists and engineers who would consider themselves to be unethical or irresponsible. That said, I know plenty of scientists who are so engaged with their work and the amazing things they believe it'll lead to that they sometimes struggle to appreciate the broader context within which they operate. The challenges surrounding ethical and responsible research are deeply pertinent to de-extinction. A couple of decades ago, they were largely academic. The imaginations of scientists back when Jurassic Park hit the screen far outstripped the techniques they had access to at the time. Things are very different now, though, as research on woolly mammoths and other extinct species is showing. In a very real way, we're entering a world that very much echoes the can-do culture of Hammond's Jurassic Park, where scientists are increasingly able to do what was once unimaginable. In such a world, where do the lines between could and should lie? And how do scientists, engineers, and others develop the understanding and ability to do what is socially responsible while avoiding what is not? Of course, this is not a new question. The tensions between technological advances and social impacts were glaringly apparent through the Industrial Revolution, as mechanization led to job losses and hardship for some. And the invention of the atomic bomb, followed by its use on Nagasaki and Hiroshima in the Second World War, took us into deeply uncharted territory when it came to balancing what we can and should do with powerful technologies. Yet in some ways, the challenges we've faced in the past over the responsible development and use of science and technology were just a rehearsal for what's coming down the pike, as we enter a new age of technological innovation. For all its scientific inaccuracies and fantastical scenarios, Jurassic Park does a good job of illuminating the challenges of unintended consequences arising from somewhat naive and myopic science. Take InGen's scientists, for instance. They're portrayed as being so enamored with what they've achieved that they lack the ability to see beyond their own brilliance to what they might have missed. Of course, they're not fools. They know that they're breaking new ground by bringing dinosaurs back to life, and that there are going to be risks. It would be problematic, for instance, if any of the dinosaurs escaped the island and survived, and they recognize this. So the scientists designed them to be dependent on a substance it was thought they couldn't get enough of naturally, the essential amino acid lysine. This was the so-called lysine contingency, and as it turns out, it isn't too dissimilar from techniques real-world genetic engineers use to control their progeny. Even though it's essential to life, lysine isn't synthesized naturally by animals. As a result, it has to be ingested, either in its raw form or by eating foods that contain it, including plants or bacteria and their products that produce it naturally, for instance, or other animals. In their wisdom, InGen's scientists assume that they can engineer lysine dependency into their dinosaurs, then keep them alive with a diet rich in the substance, thinking that they wouldn't be able to get enough lysine if they escaped. The trouble is, this contingency turns out to be about as useful as trying to starve someone by locking them in a grocery store. There's a pretty high chance that the movie's scriptwriters didn't know that this safety feature wouldn't work, or that they didn't care. Either way, it's a salutary tale of scientists who are trying to be responsible, at least their version of responsible, but are tripped up by what they don't know and what they don't care to find out. In the movie, not much is made of the lysine contingency, unlike in Michael Crichton's book that the movie's based on, where this basic oversight leads to the eventual escape of the dinosaurs from the island and onto the mainland. There is another oversight, though, that features strongly in the movie and is a second strike against the short-sightedness of the scientists involved. This is the assumption that InGen's dinosaurs couldn't breed. This is another part of the storyline where scientific plausibility isn't allowed to stand in the way of a good story. But, as with the lysine, it flags the dangers of thinking you're smart enough to have every eventuality covered. In the movie, InGen's scientists design all of their dinosaurs to be females. They're thinking, no males, no breeding, no babies, no problem. Apart from one small issue. When stitching together their fragments of dinosaur DNA with that of living species, they filled some of the holes with frog DNA. This is where we need to suspend scientific skepticism somewhat, as designing a functional genome isn't as straightforward as cutting and pasting from one animal to another. In fact, this is so far from how things work that it would be like an architect on losing a few pages from the plans of a multi-million dollar skyscraper, slipping in a few random pages from a cookie-cutter duplex and hoping for the best. The result would be a disaster. But stick with the story for the moment, because in the world of Jurassic Park, this naive mistake led to a tipping point that the scientists didn't anticipate. Just as some species of frog can switch from female to male with the right environmental stimuli, the DNA borrowed from frogs inadvertently gave the dinosaurs the same ability. And this brings us back to the real world, or at least the near-real world of de-extinction. As scientists and others begin to recreate extinct species or redesign animals based on long-gone relatives, how do we ensure that, in their cleverness, they're not missing something important? Some of this comes down to what responsible science means, which, as we'll discover in later chapters, is about more than just having good intentions. It also means having the humility to recognize your limitations and the willingness to listen to and work with others who bring different types of expertise and knowledge to the table. This possibility of unanticipated outcomes shines a bright spotlight on the question of whether some lines of research or technological development should be pursued, even if they could. Jurassic Park explores this through genetic engineering and de-extinction. But the same questions apply to many other areas of technological advancement, where new knowledge has the potential to have a substantial impact on society. And the more complex the science and technology we begin to play with is, the more pressing this distinction between could and should becomes. Unfortunately, there are no easy guidelines or rules of thumb that help decide what is probably okay and what is probably not. Although much of this book is devoted to ways of thinking that reduce the chances of making a mess of things. Even when we do have a sense of how to decide between great ideas and really bad ones, though, there's one aspect of reality we can't escape from. Complex systems behave in unpredictable ways. The butterfly effect. Michael Crichton started playing with the ideas behind Jurassic Park in the 1980s, when chaos was becoming trendy. I was an undergraduate at the time, studying physics, and it was nearly impossible to avoid the world of strange attractors and fractals. These were the years of the Mandelbrot set, and computers that were powerful enough to calculate the numbers it contained and display them as stunningly psychedelic images. The recursive complexity in the resulting fractals became the poster child for a growing field of mathematics that grappled with systems where, beyond certain limits, their behavior was impossible to predict. The field came to be known informally as chaos theory. Chaos theory grew out of the work of the American meteorologist Edward Lorenz. When he started his career, it was assumed that the solution to more accurate weather prediction was better data and better models. But in the 1950s, Lorenz began to challenge this idea. What he found was that, in some cases, minute changes in atmospheric conditions could lead to dramatically different outcomes down the line. So much so that, in sufficiently complex systems, it was impossible to predict the results of seemingly insignificant changes. In 1963, when he published the paper that established chaos theory, it was a revolutionary idea, at least to scientists who still hung on to the assumption that we live in a predictable world. Much as quantum physics challenged scientists' ideas of how predictable physical processes are in the invisible world of atoms and subatomic particles, chaos theory challenged their belief that, if we have enough information, we can predict the outcomes of our actions in our everyday lives. At the core of Lorenz's ideas was the observation that, in a sufficiently complex system, the smallest variation could lead to profound differences in outcomes. In 1969, he coined the term the butterfly effect, suggesting that the world's weather systems are so complex and interconnected that a butterfly flapping its wings on one side of the world could initiate a chain of events that ultimately led to a tornado on the other. Lorenz wasn't the first to suggest that small changes in complex systems can have large and unpredictable effects, but he was perhaps the first to pull the idea into mainstream science. And this is where chaos theory might have stayed, were it not for the discovery of the Mandelbrot set by mathematician Benoit Mandelbrot. In 1979, Mandelbrot demonstrated how a seemingly simple equation could.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.